All right, Brother Ed, come and open the Bible for us. This is Dr. Edward Wirth. We used to call him the priest of Periscope, and then they kicked him off. So now he's just Dr. Wirth, going to come preach the Bible. Thank you, sir.
Good evening. Can you ever get used to preaching behind this pulpit? I think that's why I shaved my head bald. You guys can't see all my gray hairs. No, I'm not naturally bald. Somebody said, ain't you naturally bald? Yeah. All right, if you would, open up your Bible to John chapter 18. John chapter 18. I'm going to try my best to come back to this. I want this to be my theme, but that rarely works when I make a plan to do something. So we're going to do our best, though. So John chapter 18, go down to verse 28. And the Bible says, then led they Jesus from Caiaphas unto the hall of judgment, and it was early. And they themselves went not into the judgment hall, lest they should be defiled, but that they might eat the Passover. Pilate then went out unto them and said, what accusation bring ye against this man? They answered and said unto him, if he were not a malefactor, he would not have delivered him up unto thee. Then said Pilate unto them, take ye him and judge him according to your law. The Jews therefore said unto him, it is not lawful for us to put any man to death, that the saying of Jesus might be fulfilled, which he spake, signifying what death he should die. Then Pilate entered into the judgment hall again and called Jesus and said unto him, art thou the king of the Jews? Jesus answered him, sayest thou this thing of thyself, or did others tell it thee of me? Pilate answered, am I a Jew? Thine own nation and the chief priests have delivered thee unto me. What hast thou done? Jesus answered, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight, that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from hence. Pilate therefore said unto him, art thou a king then? Jesus answered, thou sayest that I am a king? To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth. Everyone that is of the truth heareth my voice. Verse 38, Pilate saith unto him, what is truth? And when he had said this, he went out again unto the Jews and saith unto them, I find in him no fault at all. Just stop right there. Let's pray. Dear Father God, just thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you for this service tonight. All of us gathered here today to get something out of your word. I pray that each and every one of us would come home or go home with something out of your word that would change our lives. Father, we thank you for the truth, the Lord Jesus Christ. We ask you to bless this service. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, amen. All right. Well, the title, because I like giving titles, what is truth? What is truth? This will be a series. Every time I come up here and preach from now on, which is very rare, praise the Lord, because I get nervous up here, I will be preaching on truth. And we'll be revealing more intricate detail on truth. I think this is something that a lot of us neglect, the topic of truth. I think we neglect it. We take it for granted. And what I'm talking about is truth, by definition, the conceptual mechanism of truth itself. So let me make a few comments, and then we'll kind of dive into it, and we'll use scripture, and I'll try to reason with you out some of these things. And what you'll find is it'll be more of interest than you think as you listen to this, okay? Just bear with me. It might be boring a little bit, but as we dive into this, you can really see a practical application of what we're dealing with truth in every aspect of your life. All right, so truth is like gravity. You don't need to believe in it in order for it to be true. So if you're on the top of a building and you want to jump off and you say, I don't believe gravity exists, splat you go. Right? Doesn't matter how you feel about truth, correct? Just as air is required to breathe, thinking requires knowledge, and truth requires God, without knowledge and truth, nothing makes sense, not even breathing air. Doesn't make sense. Truth is not a chemical in the brain. If all human brains ceased to exist, truth would still exist. Truth is not a man-made law. If all humans ceased to exist, truth would still exist. Truth is not a belief. If all humans believe truth does not exist, truth would still exist. Truth is not an opinion. If human opinion says truth does not exist, guess what? Truth would still exist. Truth is not a feeling. If humans felt that truth does not exist, truth would still exist. Truth goes outside of our reasoning, and we use our reasoning to appeal to it. God has given every single human being the ability to have knowledge, rationality, logic, reasoning, understanding, and truth to use on a general level and as a free moral agent with free volition so we can use what God has given us to seek God so we can receive more perfect knowledge, rationality, logic, reasoning, understanding, and truth and the justification thereof. That's very important. You get that justification. You will never get beyond the general and generic truth, understanding, knowledge, and wisdom until you humble yourself, and this is more fundamental for us, and get saved. You got to get saved. You got to believe that Christ died for your sins and rose again the third day. There's something more going on. I mean, it's something more going on than just being forgiven of your sins, because there's a transformation going on within the human being the moment you're saved. Do you not become a new creature? Is your reasoning supposed to change too? And then you're to submit to the Word of God, and that's what we're talking about, the Holy Bible, so you can have the justification and validation for all truth, understanding, knowledge, and wisdom, and go on, as David preached last week, go on to perfection, Hebrews chapter 6. Difference between understanding, knowledge, and wisdom, and God gives humanity all three. Come on, right? Understanding, knowledge, and wisdom. He gives us that on a general level, but he also gives it in the transformed life after you get saved. Ain't that amazing? A lost person has understanding, knowledge, and wisdom. But it doesn't save them. It's not godly understanding. It's not godly knowledge. It's not godly wisdom. So you got to get saved in order to obtain to the justification and validation of truth, knowledge, logic, and reasoning. So what people got to work with right now is just the bare necessities of what God's given them. So everybody's on an equal level playing field, but what are you going to do with what God's given you? Are you going to respond to truth? Are you going to respond to the reasoning that God has given you? Are you going to respond to the knowledge that God's given you? So here's just kind of dive into this just a little bit. As a lost person, we just said this. You have understanding, which is the thinking and the reasoning. To utilize knowledge, that's what? Facts, information, opinions, and truth claims. And you have understanding. That's the thinking and the very reasoning. So to take the knowledge, which is the facts, information, opinions, and truth, and all the truth claims that you come up with, to obtain wisdom is how to use the facts and information and opinions and truth claims. That's what we mean by those things. So all three of those things are distinct in the Bible. A lot of times when we read the Bible, we say, well, no, I can't. I see a lot of things that are interchangeable. Well, I'm telling you, if you read this in this light that I'm telling you, that you take understanding as the very reasoning that you have to use the knowledge and the wisdom. Because, come on, that's what knowledge is, right? It's a bunch of facts, and you got to use those facts with your reasoning so you can have wisdom. All right, well, as a saved person, the Holy Spirit changes our understanding, knowledge, and wisdom. Now, a proof of that would be Exodus 31:3, and we're not going to hit that right now. Exodus 31:3 and Exodus 35:31. You can just use that as a cross reference. In the Bible, they sound interchangeable, but they are not. The Holy Spirit does a work on all three. All three get worked on by the Holy Spirit. So concerning saved people, understanding. Now we can turn here for these. Look at understanding in Ephesians 1:18. Ephesians 1:18. You can hold your spot in John 18 because we're going to come back there. Ephesians 1:18. Just pay attention here. The eyes of your understanding, what? Being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling and what is the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. So what's going on in your understanding as a saved member of the body of Christ? It's being enlightened. Lost people don't got that, do they? Nope. Colossians 3:10. Go there. Colossians 3:10. Talk about knowledge. And just go back a verse here. Lie not one to another, seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deeds, and have put on the new man, which is renewed in what? Knowledge, after the image of him that created him. Now, the image of him, after the image of him. Do you know when we're dealing with the image of God? There's so much more going on in this verse than you think it is. Because notice, as the new creature, we're compared to the image of God. Now, I'm going to come back to that. I want you to just keep that in the back of your mind. It's really interesting as to the moral issues of truth that we're going to be covering. Now, we did that as Colossians 3:10. Now, look at wisdom. So we did understanding. We did knowledge. Now, look at wisdom. 1 Corinthians 2:13. 1 Corinthians 2:13. And we'll go back a verse here. Now, in verse 12, 1 Corinthians 2:12. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God, which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. You guys catch on to the word wisdom there? All right. There's three things changed within the believer. It's reasoning, their reasoning, or their what we call understanding, knowledge, and wisdom. Now, true, none of us have complete knowledge that God has. I mean, come on, I hope I'm preaching to the choir on that. But we have what we call a non-communicable attribute of God's knowledge that he gives us the moment we get saved. We don't have complete infinite knowledge, but we have a non-communicable attribute that he gives us. So it's more of a finite thing that the Holy Spirit gives us, but it's to understand the complete mind of God. So God doesn't leave us without, you know, any witness or any truth. We have the word of truth right there in front of us, holding it in your hand. All right, so let's go back to John chapter 18. I want to show you something about truth here. Pilate saith unto him in verse 38, Pilate saith unto him, what is truth? Now, for Pilate to ask that question, he is basing that question upon a standard of what? Truth. Is it true that you don't know what truth is? You guys don't see the foolishness? It's a contradiction. It caves in on itself. Anybody that asks what is truth is an idiot. It's a fool. It's a fool. You're a fool. Because every day you deal in truth in your life. Okay, well, for you to find fault. Now, look at this. Just read on down. And when he had said this, he went out again unto the Jews and saith unto them, I find in him no fault at all. This guy just said, what is truth? And then he's saying to the people out there, oh, I find no fault in him. Well, how do you measure fault? By a standard of what fault is not. So you need a plumb line of truth. Here's a guy that said, what is truth? And he's just a complete idiot. To deny or question truth makes you a fool. Now, let's go over some of these. Because, I mean, some people think, well, this is outrageous. You're kind of unloving, brother. Okay, go Deuteronomy 32:4. Deuteronomy 32:4. I'll hit a few of these, and then we'll kind of move on to the next section here. Look at Deuteronomy 32:4. He is the rock. Who's the he? That's the Lord God. His work is perfect, for all his ways are judgment, a God of lies, a God of opinions, a God of truth, and without iniquity, just. That's the root word for justice. Just and right is he. Go to Psalms 31:5. We're talking about truth. What is truth? Go to Psalms 31:5. I know it sounds kind of basic, but I'm going to show you something that's really profound. Even when you're witnessing out on the street to people, I'm going to show you something that's really profound. A lot of people don't even utilize when they're witnessing to people. Yeah, it's going to be very helpful. Psalm 31:5. The God of truth is in the business of redemption. Look at Psalm 31:5. Into thine hand I commit my spirit. Thou hast redeemed me, O God. I'm sorry, I didn't hit the right one there. Yeah, I'm going to have to go to my next one here. I'm sorry. Yeah, that is it. I'm sorry. Into thine hand I commend my spirit. Thou hast redeemed me, O Lord, God of truth. So God is in the redeeming business, and he's the God of truth. And go to Psalm 33:4. I'm going to hit a few of these because we got a lot to cover here. Psalm 33:4. For the word of the Lord is somewhat right. Sometimes right. I think it's right. No, for the word of the Lord is right, and all his works are done in truth. It's not just some random thing that's out there that we call truth. It's truth. It's the truth that every human being needs to appeal to. I'm going to show you the difference of view that people have on that. That's why when people go out and they leave the church house, they don't have that view. They don't say, well, my God is a God of truth. No, he's the God of my truth. No, it doesn't say he's the God of truth. There is a concept of truth that every human being has to appeal to, and God himself is the justification for the very concept of truth. You can't make sense of truth without God. You say, well, that's only in the Bible. No, it's anybody. Even lost people have to appeal to it. You ask a lost person, where do you get truth without God? They can't answer you. All right, so look at Proverbs 15:2. Proverbs 15:2. The tongue. The tongue of the wise. Any wise tongues in here? The tongue of the wise useth knowledge aright, but the mouth of fools poureth out foolishness. How are you wise? You've got to appeal to a standard of truth to be wise. You've got to appeal to a standard of truth to have knowledge aright. How can somebody judge the mouth of fools? And I was pouring out foolishness. If you've got no measure to a standard or plumb line to judge if something's foolish, you don't. Not without God. Proverbs 15:2. Yeah, I think we just did that, and you can cross reference that with Jeremiah 17:9. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Who would ever trust in their heart? But you'll be surprised. Probably all of us did when we were still lost and undone. Now, I'm going to just give you some references here, and you can write them down or not. We're just trying to get to the meat of the study here. Psalm 105 proves that truth is unchanging. Psalm 108, verse 4, proves that truth is universal. Psalm 119:142 shows that God's law is the truth. Psalm 119, verse 30 says, the way of truth must be chosen. Psalm 119:151 shows that all God's law is true, not just some parts. Psalm 145:18 is calling on God must be done, or the calling on God must be done in truth. And Proverbs 12:17, speaking truth shows righteousness. Proverbs 12:19, truth spoken is forever established. It does not contradict. Proverbs 14:22, truth is what's used by those that purpose good. you learn all this stuff, right? You look it all up. You're like, yeah, this is great stuff, man. And then you go out there and you try to convince somebody to believe in Jesus Christ by giving 101 evidences. Why don't you use truth? Truth is the most prevalent thing in the Word of God. I could win somebody to Jesus by just preaching the truth. Why do I want to trust in what man wants to trust in? I mean, historians look up evidences. You know, historians and scientists look for evidences. Why do we base our whole Christianity on empiricism? Don't the Word of God say, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature? The evidences were already given. Why do we need to go out and say, well, even though the evidences were already given and proclaimed in the Old Testament and in the New Testament, because Jesus fulfilled all the Old Testament, correct? So why am I going to sit there and rehash something that the apostles had already seen and witnessed? But that's what we do. Like, well, what the apostles did in the Bible isn't enough. So we got to go find the most current findings of the Bible, most current findings of archaeology. Oh, man, they got a thing on dark matter. We better try to find a way to answer that. You know, they found some missing links. Let's find a way to answer that. I'm like, preach to them the gospel. It's enough. It's the power of God and the salvation to everyone that believes. If they don't want it, they're going to perish. We put so much stock in our own ways, how to do things. Well, I've always did this as a Christian. I don't know any other way. Brother Ed, I think you're over the edge there. I'm going to keep doing what I'm doing. I'm like, why don't you just trust the Bible? The Bible's true. That should be enough for you. It's not for most. Go to Isaiah 1:18. I'm going to show you something. Isaiah 1:18. The Bible says, not Brother Ed, the Bible says, come now, and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. So the reasoning is to get you to being as wool, correct? That would be the end of the matter. But does not God say that he wants to reason with you? Which means what? This is going to be great in part two to my sermon, but we can't cover this. But we can reason. Say, wow, what a big revelation. No, I'm serious. We can reason. God has given you reasoning. It doesn't come from some, you know, billions and billions of years of primordial ooze. God has given you the ability to reason today. And he says, come now and let us reason together, saith the Lord. God is saying, I reason and I've given you the ability to reason so we can reason together. These are truths people just undermine. They don't even care about that. Like, go on. Let me hear the deep, more deep spiritual thing. That is deep and spiritual. Without reasoning, you couldn't trust in Jesus Christ. It takes your reasoning to hear the facts, to hear the knowledge, to hear the logic, so you can believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. If you don't have valid reasoning, you can't trust in Jesus Christ. God is still just. I mean, I know somebody's going to ask that question. God is still just in how he judges people. Even that can't even reason validly. But that's not the point. You have reasoning today. And it's because of the glory of God. God is saying through the prophet Isaiah that we have the ability to reason and come to logical conclusions as the originator of reasoning comes to logical conclusions. Wow, that's amazing. When I said originator, that's capital O originator, okay? We are created in the image of God, even though man lost the likeness of God. Why are we to come to logical conclusions about anything? Think about it. Isaiah 1:18. We talk about the end of the matter, right? So we get saved. But wait a minute. When you get saved, is that not coming to the knowledge of the truth? Because when you get saved, you can now understand real truth that comes from God, the originator. So the purpose of reasoning is to seek truth. Is something good? Now, this is what I get at the University of Central Florida a lot. These philosophy students, they get out of their critical thinking class and they walk up to me and they want to try to trick me. Which that's why a lot of our church members here and church members everywhere else, they don't want to come down there. They don't want to deal with people that want to trick them. Yeah, they think they're so smart, that's why I don't want to go down there. Well, you need to show them they're not smart. Show them they can't know anything. Something, look, Is something good because God says it's good? Or is something good because it's good? Now, the reason why they ask that is because it's Euthyphro's dilemma in philosophy class. Is something good because God says it's good? So they're saying that if God says you can just go ahead and commit murder and rape, then it's good. So they're trying to give you an arbitrary standard there that God can just say anything is good. And so they're trying to get you in a corner. And then they say, is something good because God is good? Now, if you answer yes to that, see, you get the double whammy. Both answers are wrong. But watch this. If you say yes to that, like if something's good because it's good, now God has something that's above him that he has to appeal to. So he's not the God of all things. So see, they're trying to get you in this double, there's dead ends on both sides. Do you know why something is good? Because God is good. His character. It's his character. That's why something is wrong. That's why something is right. You know why murder is wrong? It's not because it hurts people. It's because God is not a murderer. It's his character. Are we not created in the image of God? That's why murder is wrong. People want to try to stipulate some arbitrary reasons why something is wrong. I'm telling you, something's wrong is because God, the creator of all things, including morality, is because his character says our character should not be that. So how do you justify all that? Well, the Bible. See how easy it is? See, we got a standard. World don't got a standard. The world got to stipulate some morality that they got to contradict each other. Well, I think rape is wrong. And the other guy comes around, well, I don't think rape is wrong. I think, you know, raping certain people is wrong. And this other guy comes along, well, I don't think that's wrong. You know, I think you could just rape anybody. And they have no way of differentiating who's right, who's wrong morally, which is a huge problem. Regression, regression, regression when you deny God. People are not looking to the standard of truth, the plumb line to truth, the validation and justification for truth, the foundation of truth, the calibration of truth. They are looking to their society, their friends, music, their own heart. You hear the violins playing. You say something that's truthful against what they really, really believe in their heart, the violins just play louder and louder, right? You know what Proverbs 18:2 says? A fool hath no delight in understanding. No delight. But that his heart may discover itself. I ain't worried about truth. I'm worried about my heart discovering itself. I want you to worry about your heart discovering itself. And if you don't want to let your heart discover itself, I'm going to kill you. And that's based on truth. See, it's contradictory. So the Bible is called the what? The canon. We got the canon of 66 books in the Bible, right? What is a canon? Anybody know what a canon is? It's a measuring rod. It's a calibration for our lives every day. He'll say basic instructions before leaving. It's not basic. It's not basic. It's how we ought to live our lives intricately for God and love for him through the Lord Jesus Christ. So are we reasoning with God to get to the truth? God says if we reason correctly, salvation can result. And according to 1 Timothy 2:4, who will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth by appealing to truth and responding, we can come to that knowledge of the truth after one gets saved. So you already got truth. You got truth right now. But it's not the truth that God wants you to have according to the Word of God. But you got enough truth, enough to find that you got that GPS that's bringing you on, that should bring you on a one-way course to God. Truth itself should do that. I don't need 101 evidence. Truth itself should bring you on a one-way course to God. Why doesn't it? Romans 1. Because they hold the truth in unrighteousness. That's why. It's by their own volition, by their own free will. Truth could bring them the right direction to God, but they hold the truth in unrighteousness. Why? John chapter 3, because men love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. There's a motive behind why people don't want truth. Certainty. Can anybody have certainty? Can any of you guys have certainty? Now, if you say no, you better watch out. Because I'm going to say, are you certain that you can't have certainty? I'm going to get you with it. People laugh. They think, oh, that's kind of cute, Brother Ed. That's cute you said that. Now let's get on to the real conversation. I'm not going to go on. We're going to stop right there, because if you're contradicting yourself right there and saying, well, I can't be certain about anything, and I'm saying, well, you just made a certain knowledge claim. Well, we can't go past that. Because how am I going to deal with certainty with somebody about eternal life, salvation, if they can't even validate or just agree with the truth of certainty? You can't go anywhere. You know, by the way, certainty is truth. You understand that, right? You're certain about something. You're saying something is true for certain. That's certainty. Now, let's prove that. Look at Luke 1:4. Luke chapter 1, verse 4. Watch this. We're going to go back a few verses here. Let's start at verse 1. For as much as many have taken in hand to set forth in order to declaration of those things which are most, look at this, most surely believed among us, even as they delivered them unto us, which from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the world. It seemed good to me also, having had perfect, that's pretty bold, perfect understanding of all things from the very first, to write unto thee in order, most excellent Theophilus. Now watch this. This is so bold. Look at verse 4. That thou mightest know the certainty of those things wherein thou hast been instructed. Can I be certain of what was instructed to me from the Word of God? Philosophy students say no. University students say no. PhD professor at the university says no. The Bible says I can be certain. Who do I believe? I can be certain about what was instructed to me in the Bible. I come to church week after week, and I hear knowledge from the Word of God. I get understanding from the Word of God. I get wisdom from the Word of God. And you know what I can say after I learn this stuff and I study it out myself? I can say I know that for certain. 1 John chapter 5 says that we can know that we have eternal life, and that we may believe on the name of the Son of God. Is that knowledge right there being talked about in 1 John chapter 5? Is that certain knowledge? Or is that, I think so. I could be wrong. I could be wrong about having eternal life, according to 1 John chapter. Who says that? You come down here, you hear a sermon on 1 John chapter 5. I can know I have eternal life. Brother James just gets done preaching. You come down to the altar and a tear in your eye. Say, I know I got eternal life. I'm praying. I'm like, God, thank you for the knowledge of knowing for certain I have eternal life. And then you go out into the world and you witness to people. Say, well, God might be true. He might be the King of glory. Well, I don't know. Let's look at the evidence. Well, I'll try to take a neutral stand, and I'll just try to reason with you that God is real. Who does that? I'll tell you, I did it. I witnessed that way. I used to witness that way all the time. But then I realized, after learning the Bible, and that's why God has grace with us, right? God has grace with everybody. We need to stand on the Word of God. When the Word of God says in Genesis chapter 1, in the beginning, God gave you 1,000,000,001 proofs that he exists and he created the heavens and the earth. Nope, doesn't say that, does it? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and there's nowhere in there that proved it. God says the proof is the very reasoning that we have. People say, well, you can look at creation, but you got to use your reasoning when looking at creation. Your very reasoning is the proof that God exists. You couldn't reason about anything. And we're talking about truth tonight. You can't even reason about truth if you're not using your reasoning. You can't know what truth is. So the very vehicle that we use to understand truth, knowledge, science, logic, everything, is based upon our reasoning. So you can't even make sense of truth. It's pretty amazing that God gives us his reasoning. This non-communicable attribute of reasoning, it's pretty amazing. So certainty. I want to show you something. Look at Deuteronomy 13, 14. This is interesting too. And we'll start in verse 13, Deuteronomy 13, 13. Look what it says. Certain men and children of Belial are gone out from among you and have withdrawn the inhabitants of their city, saying, let us go and serve other gods, which ye have not known. Look at verse 14. Then shalt thou inquire. Inquire? You're investigating. Why would you investigate? Well, we just believe everything by blind faith as Christians, right? We don't investigate nothing. We're a bunch of fools that just believe in faith when all these people in these schools believe in science. Science. You guys got that weak faith. We got science. It's amazing, isn't it? Wow. To just the ignorance of, but look at this. Thou shalt inquire. God's telling the nation of Israel to inquire and make search. Hey, search. I'm looking. I got my magnifying glass out. I'm looking. Ask diligently. Oh, man, it doesn't just say ask. Oh, hey, you seen that guy that did that the other day? We're trying to arrest him. No, ask diligently. Look, we're gonna put you in a room. We're gonna investigate you. We're gonna ask you 3,000 questions till 4 in the morning. And behold, watch, if it be truth, and the thing, look, certain. Well, can I investigate and find something to be true and certain? The answer, according to the Bible, is yes, that such abomination is wrought among you. Do you see the just way that Israel had to investigate crimes? Interesting. What do you think people come up with these law books and how to investigate evidences and deal with evidences and empiricism in courts of law? They get it from the Word of God. They get it from the Bible. So it's pretty interesting that God says there are things that we know that He reveals to us that we know for certain. We don't know all things, but there are certain things we can know. Like, you said, give us an example, Brother Ed. Okay, I can know I'm standing up here behind a pulpit preaching to you. I know that for certain. And if you're saying, well, I don't know for certain if I'm listening to you, well, there's more problems that you got to deal with than I can help you with, okay? All right, so look, I'm trying to show you that there are things that God requires us to investigate, and there are things that God says, I reveal to you, and you can know things for certain. So I can use my reasoning that God's given me to investigate things, and then there are other things that I can just say, hey, I know I love my wife. Well, no, you perceive you love your wife. You don't really know it. Who says that kind of stuff? Probably lose your wife if she heard you say that. So, relative truth doesn't work, right? It doesn't work. I mean, just me saying that. You say, yeah, it doesn't work. Relative truth doesn't work when someone attacks you. So, well, what if the person attacking me said, well, truth is relative, and I thought it was for the greatest good that I attacked you. Because when I attacked you and killed you, you know, you could never feel pain anymore. I was thinking about the good that could come from it. Seriously? Relative truth doesn't work when someone's attacking you or somebody's stealing from you or killing your family members or burning your house down or crashes into your car. All of a sudden, now truth is absolute. Now truth, oh man, we got to take this guy to court. I need some justice. Now, a few more here, and then we'll close out. I got like 30 pages of notes here. We can't get through all this. Go to Jeremiah 51, 15. Jeremiah 51, 15. Jeremiah 51, 15. I want to show you, because people think when I talk about truth, it's just some philosophy that I came up with. I mean, when I go out to the street, there's people that claim to be saved that say, I just think, you know, that's not even scriptural what you're doing. Look, I'm going through it right now. Look, if you disagree with me, come talk to me. I got verses to back up why I preach the way I preach. Jeremiah 51, 15. Look what it says. He hath made the earth by his power. He hath established the world by his what? The whole world, including all non-believers? Yes. He's established the world by his wisdom and hath stretched out the heaven by his what? Understanding. Guess what that covers? All the scientific method, law of induction, law of uniformity in nature, the law of gravity, the law of thermodynamics, second law of thermodynamics, third law of thermodynamics, you know, anything you can deal with the relativity of light, and come on, any name it. All the laws, right there, Jeremiah 51:15, including the very framework for your reasoning. Job 38:36. Look at this one. Job 38:36. So this is going to be more, this is a fundamental study. But I want you to know that the truth is the most valued treasure that you have in your arsenal when you're dealing with saved people or lost people. Look at Job 38:36. Who hath put wisdom in the inward parts? Or who hath given understanding to the heart? Now, we don't have time to go over Nebuchadnezzar and all that and having the heart of a beast and all this. But I tell you this. That right there, Job 38:36, that's not only a revelation of God giving somebody that's obedient understanding. It goes a step further. That every single human being, when they get to an age of what we call understanding, God's the one that gives it to them. Otherwise, they couldn't have some toddler that ends up growing and growing could never get any understanding because you would have to teach him the laws of logic. You have to say, well, here, little Billy, let me explain to you the law of identity. Now, when I point to that, that equals that. You don't got to teach your kids that. It's common sense. You don't got to teach your kids the law of non-contradiction. You don't got to teach your kids the law of excluded middle. These are things that are what we call, when we call common sense, I call revelation from God. That all comes from God. It's manifested, sanctioned knowledge that God gives every human being. And it doesn't save you, but it ought to draw you straight towards more light. But like we said, a lot of times it doesn't because the heart of man is to continuously want to do evil and seek out his own inventions and you know, go towards lies, go towards loving their evil, wicked deeds, to love darkness rather than light. That's what man wants to do. But God doesn't put it in the heart for people to do that. They do it themselves. So when we're talking about truth, yeah, people use truth every day. Lost people use truth every day, and a lot of lost people are still lost. But I just ask the question, how do you validate truth? How do you justify truth? Ask them. Ask them what Pilate asked Jesus. What is truth? Ask them that. Instead of them asking you, you ask them, what is truth? Because I can't see how anybody could get truth without God. It's impossible. And what you'll find is there is no answer. They can give you no answer because all you're left with is foolishness. It's foolishness. It's the opposite of truth. It leaves you in foolishness. Okay, and go to Psalm 51:6. Psalm 51:6. The Bible says to David, after he, you know, committed his sins plural, behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part, thou shalt make me to know wisdom. God desires truth in the inward parts. God says, look, if you want to desire lies for yourself, in the end, in the judgment, God's going to desire truth anyways. So you do well to just start appealing to truth right now. But look how powerful this is. When you're appealing to people out on the street or just witnessing to people, you ask them, I want to tell you what Jesus Christ did for me on the cross. He died for my sins. He rose again the third day, justifying me from my sins. That's the truth. Well, right, the next question, well, why should I believe that's the truth? I mean, you got the Muslims, you get all the arguments. I say, well, I'm saying this because it's the truth. But how do you get out of all these other ones? Did you study Islam? Did you study Jehovah's Witnesses? I said, I don't have to study those. Why not? So you're not being objective if you don't study them all. I don't have to study them all. Look, one thing I'm going to close out here. One thing. Is 1 plus 1 2? Now, according to the logic of somebody telling you, for you to say that Jesus died for your sins and rose again a third day, and I say that's true, I'm giving you the proper right answer, the only right answer. 1 plus 1 is 2 is the only right answer. Now, I didn't have to study 1 plus 1 is 3, okay, that's wrong. 1 plus 1 is 4, that's wrong. I didn't have to study an infinite amount of wrong math problems to know 1 plus 1 is 2. It's ridiculous. But this is what people want you to do. Study all the religions, and when you know something about all the religions, then you can come to the knowledge of the truth. I don't know. The Bible says God wants all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth, not by checking every false religion in the world, but to respond to what I know to be true. And every single human being can do that. All right, let's go ahead and that's it. That's what I have for tonight. Let's pray. Dear Holy Heavenly Father, just thank you for your grace, your mercy, your love to us. Thank you for your truth. Father, thank you for the word of truth. Thank you for Jesus Christ, the way, the truth, and the life. Father, thank you so much for salvation and how true it really is in reality, Father. Help us to be encouraged by your truth, Father, to not be ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Father, I pray for each and every person here that they get a hold of these truths and they might change their lives for your glory and praise. In the name of Lord Jesus Christ, amen.